Hello and welcome to the Grand Line Review, your source for everything One Piece. Today we have a manga review of chapter 936, The Great Sumo Inferno Tournament. And so I think the thing we mostly all predicted has come to fruition, with a death match of sorts being put into action by Queen, which is finally giving us a taste of his more sadistic side with the collar and everything. And the best part of all of this was any time that Luffy interacted with Queen, because Queen is just ridiculous enough to get caught up in Luffy's idiocy. And I really, really enjoyed when Luffy called him Balloon Guy. In doing so, Luffy also set his own victory conditions for the Great Sumo Inferno, even if it isn't set up to be a contest that one can actually win. It's more about delaying death or simply giving up. So it seems that we're going to send in wave after wave of increasingly stronger opponents, video game style, for Luffy to trash, which is quite convenient, really, because I imagine that after a certain amount of time, pretty much every relevant officer figure within the prisoner mine will be rendered out of action, thus making the eventual chaotic escape significantly easier. Realistically speaking, though, without the sea stone cuffs, it's got to come down to Queen entering the ring himself, because surely there's nobody else here who could handle Luffy. And from there, we have a few possibilities. The most likely one in my mind is that their conflict gets interrupted by the Big Mom escape team, although given how goofy Queen is, I also wouldn't put it past Oda to craft a more comical ending to the tournament, where Queen is accidentally forced out of the ring somehow in a shocking turn of events. But the tournament does begin this week, and there is an absolutely beautifully drawn panel of Luffy activating Conqueror's Haki, which seems so simple, you know? It's a straight-on shot of just half of his face, but Luffy's expression is just terrifyingly perfect. Like, if you ever see someone smiling at you like that, then you know you're in for a bad time. I guess the other thing to flag here is that Kawamatsu has a connection to Hyogoro, so he is very potentially an ex-Yakuza himself. Once again, he remains completely enshrouded though, and I find it quite interesting that Oda is going to such great lengths to keep him hidden. It's really building the anticipation for one hell of a big reveal of this character, which can go one of two ways really. Either we're going to be introduced to some tragically maimed and malnourished individual with some heavy, heavy shock value, or we're going to be introduced to another completely absurd looking citizen of Wano, possibly the most absurd looking we've seen so far. And I know that a lot of people are hoping for Kawamatsu to look like an incredible badass, but at this stage I can definitely see the latter option occurring. Another unexpected highlight of the chapter for me though was anytime Raizo was present at all. I feel like I've said this before, but this ninja has really grown on me. When he was first introduced during Zo, I was pretty disappointed, but his comic value just cannot be denied. I loved the part in the beginning where he was stealthily speaking with Kawamatsu, but as soon as the cart behind him moved away, his gigantic and not at all classically ninja form was put on full display and immediately spotted by the guards. He also had another great moment where he claimed that he'd put in a lot of work to get the key to Luffy's handcuffs as they were being taken off him. So yeah, at the moment, he is far and away my favorite member of the Kinemon gang. And the saddest stuff about the potential of the prisoner mine stuff ending is that we won't be able to see any more of Raizo's madness in there. All right, on to the next half or so of the chapter though. And we are back at the bathhouse. I spent some time last week arguing that what we saw was completely unnecessary, as well as the fact that I'd gladly eat my words if Oda made it relevant to the plot. So I'm going to concede this week that the bathhouse, for better or worse, was very relevant to the plot. I am still really conflicted though. On the one hand, I do make a point to defend wacky moves by Oda, because that really is the core fabric of One Piece. On the other hand, I don't think what happened here was, you know, quite wacky enough to justify so easily evading two members of the worst generation. Like, sure, Drake can't handle naked women, that's fine. That doesn't damage his character any more than it damages, say, Sanji's character. In fact, I'm quite happy that we finally actually learnt something about the guy's personality. Hawkins is very much a different matter though. I'm still not entirely sure what happened here, to be honest, because he was on the verge of capturing or wounding or whatever Nami, and then as soon as her towel slipped off, he just disappeared. He doesn't seem to have been knocked out with the happiness punch, and it's just really unclear what happened from that point onwards until he reappeared when Drake came in. Initially, what I thought had happened was that Sanji got sent flying back into Hawkins while he was still invisible, but yeah, I don't know, and I think the whole scene in general is just a bit clunkily put together. Another example is that we immediately cut from Sanji on the ground in a bad situation to him skywalking with Nami, Robin, and Shinobu. And it's just like, wait. How did you escape both Drake and Hawkins? And yeah, I'm sure that's something that the anime will expand on, but it felt a bit weird in the chapter. And I can't help but feel like these little oddities are all for the sake of a bathhouse scene, which, you know, delivered on its promises, I guess, with a very, very naked Nami. But whether or not that was worth it, yeah, I'm not so sure. I did enjoy that both Drake and Hawkins were able to recognize Stealth Black, though. They probably won't be able to put together that it's Sanji, because they seem to have been fairly isolated as of late, and they probably aren't aware of the whole Vinsmo connection. But it would be interesting if they, say, reported to Kaido that the German were present on Wano, and then they got embroiled in everything just by association. You know, if they're, I guess, even still alive after Whole Cake Island, that is. And the final piece of this chapter moves us to the mysterious wanderings of Zoro, which I quite like because when you think about it, the chapter mainly focuses on three characters, Luffy, Sanji, and Zoro. So it felt like a nice catch up with the monster trio. But in regards to the Zoro section, there is a great panel on the last page where Zoro has his evil smile on. It's very reminiscent of Luffy's smile earlier in the chapter, and it's how you know that shit is about to go down. But as suspected, the Shusui has been taken, so for now Zoro is a Nitoryu user, although I don't think that's going to last particularly long given that we have Mr. Weapons Collector over here. Although the interesting thing is that Zoro doesn't seem overly concerned with losing Shusui, which you know he's held and mastered for 2 years. So it may very well be much easier than expected to get the Nidai Kitetsu into his hands as well, which I'd be incredibly hyped for. Zoro testing out and getting to know new blades is always fun. Plus, I should mention that Zoro's entire environment at the moment is just stunning. There is nothing more picturesque than a battle between swordsmen on a bridge in the snow. As a result, I do hope that we see more of the fight, but this does seem set up so that we can just cut to the results of the conflict at a later chapter. Like Zoro rocks up to Kinemon with a sack full of weapons and casually states that he beat a dude sort of thing. But all in all, this was a fairly solid chapter. Things are moving on Wano. In fact, I didn't even mention the whole Heart Pirates being captured and that Law's about to be activated in a big way. And there's also the idea that was suggested by Shinobu that their plan was leaked, implying that there may be a traitor amongst the Alliance, which is incredibly intriguing. So there is a lot going on here and I love it. Overall, it was really enjoyable. And I think it was very wise to put the bathhouse stuff in the middle of the chapter because it had a strong beginning and a strong ending with some clunky stuff in the middle, which structurally leaves me with a very good impression of it. But that pretty much does it for chapter 936. If you enjoyed this video and the content this channel produces in general, then please do consider donating to the Grand Line Review Patreon because the support of all of you amazing people is what continues to make this channel possible. Also, do check out my Teespring store if you're interested in shirts, hoodies, and other miscellaneous items, with the proceeds going directly to support the channel as well. And if you'd like to join the fun at any time, then please do head over to my Discord server where a wide array of shenaniganry takes place on a daily basis. And finally, please do comment with your thoughts on the chapter. This has been the Grand Line Review, and I'll see you next time.